used to be a place in New York called Lewisohn Stadium. It was a big track field up at City College, up in Harlem on City College. And they used to do jazz concerts in the summer. And I went and saw Duke Ellington. So I went to the back of the stadium after the concert was over, and they were putting all their things in the bus. And I walked up to him and I said, "Oh, Mr. Ellington, how are you?" And he shook my hand and said, "What is your name?" And I told him, he said, "Oh, how is your father doing?" Because my father had played with him back in 1947. And I said, "Oh, he's doing fine, everything's fine." You know, I met him. But you know, a lot of those people lived in my neighborhood, in Washington Heights. Duke Ellington, Johnny Hodges, Coleman Hawkins, Billie Holiday. I would see them all. But like I say, I knew who they were, and I knew they were into music, but I was into baseball. Well, my dad was a musician, was a trumpet player, Dud Bascom. He was around for many years, played with Erskine Hawkins, Duke Ellington. But then when he left the road work, you know, he stopped going out of town a lot, and he started doing recording sessions here in town back in the 50s and 60s. And he met Purdy, and he told me one day that he was recording at Columbia Records. Would I like to come? So I brought a high school friend down. We were in high school at the time. And that's how I met Purdy. I knew of him before that, but I met him on that recording session. And then the year after that, when I got out of high school, Purdy had a job up in the Bronx here in New York in a nightclub every weekend. And I started working with him. Then we left that job and we went down to a Lloyd Price, rhythm blues singer Lloyd Price had a club here in town where the old Birdland used to be. Lloyd Price's turntable, I started working with him there. But see, at that time, that's all we did and all we had to do was just either do a job on the weekend, a dance or a wedding reception, stuff. But during the week, record, record, record. There was such a big recording scene here, you know, and it's just gone now. You know, I mean, electronic music, just by the time the 80s came in, electronic music just, you know, wiped it out. We used to see each other all the time because every musician in town that was recording, you would pass them on the street. "Where are you going, man?" "Oh, I'm going to so-and-so." "Well, I'll meet you at so-and-so. I'll see you later on." And you'd have this camaraderie and you'd see them all the time. But now, very seldom see each other. You know, it goes through a whole recording scene. It's just shot. It's gone. There was a very big commercial scene in New York for TV commercials, radio commercials, and that's pretty much gone now because they hardly need arrangers anymore, orchestrators anymore. They don't get hired that much anymore to do orchestrations because people do them themselves with the electronics. So that's gone too, so we don't see each other anymore, you know. But that was a great scene. So there was so much going on then, it's kind of difficult to keep track of everything you've done. I have all my session books though. I have to look up and see if I have it in there, but I don't remember it off the top of my head. I don't remember that one. Yeah, but if they say I'm on there, I'll take it. Yeah, I remember working with Roy Ayers. That was a while back. Yeah, as a matter of fact, I remember going in there once, way back in the 60s. And I saw this big thing on the wall over there with all these holes in it. And I said to the engineer, I said, an electric lady, I said, "What is that?" And he said, "Oh, that's a synthesizer." I said, "A what?" He said, "A synthesizer." I said, "What does it do?" He says, "Well, it makes music, synthetic music." I said, and my first impression then was, uh-oh, I think this might be the beginning of the end. Didn't happen for a while, but that was the first place I ever heard the term or ever saw it. That was at Jimi Hendrix's place, Electric Lady.